This is Dr. Ali Mugabel, and we're considering linear transformation of Gaussian random variables. Linear transformation of Gaussian random variables. Now, x1, x2, up to x sub capital N are jointly Gaussian random variables. We know that PDF is jointly Gaussian. Our job is to find the joint PDF for the linear transformation. Linear transformation means the output is related to the input through linear equation. So let's say that we have multiple output functions, y1, y2, up to y sub n. So we're using the same number of inputs, the same number of outputs. In general, they could be different. So we could have y1, y2, up to ym, but we're just making it the same. So if we pick the coefficient and shown in red here, these are the coefficient that relates y to x. We can see we can form a transformation matrix, capital T, which is made of all the entries. Remember that this transformation is linear. So the output is a scaled version of the input random variables. We can define four different vectors. The first one, the vector y, which is vector of the output random variables. Y bar is the average of the output random variables. X is the input random vector. And X bar is the vector of the average of the input random variables. So we are doing transformation from X to Y using this linear transformation. And hence we have defined the capital T transformation, or the capital T matrix, which contains all the elements. So the question in hand is, what is the PDF of y and how do we find it? We can use vector notation to represent the equations on the left. So y equal to t multiplied by x, or inversely, we can say x is the inverse matrix of t multiplied by y. And they are also related by the following. If you subtract the average, we can also write x minus x bar in terms of inverse function. So these are different ways of writing the relation. The T matrix for our solution to work must be non-singular, because remember, we need to find y, we'll need to find the inverse transformation. So that requires the transformation matrix to be non-singular. Now, to continue with linear transformation of Gaussian random variables, we can write x in terms of the inverse of t, so it's the inverse of, we can find all the variables using the inverse transformation. Now, just to distinguish, I'm using the blue color here for the inverse transformation, and I will be using the superscript. So the entries of the inverse transformation matrix is A11, A12, and so on, and these are written in the superscript just to distinguish. That's to say, if you differentiate this linear equation with respect to y1, you will get the first entry here. If you differentiate the second entry with respect to y2, and so on. So those entries in blue are the entries of the inverse transformation matrix. We're defining the Jacobian as the absolute value of the determinant of the inverse transformation matrix. You can write it this way, or you can write it this way if you like. So the first two lines represent the determinant, and then we have the second two lines to represent the absolute value. So if the determinant turns out to be negative, we take the absolute value of that. The conclusion, the output transformation, the output PDF equal to the input PDF multiplied by the absolute value of the Jacobian. Cool. This is for the two random variable case. We can generalize for the multiple random variables. So after a few steps, we can show that the output of a linear transformation of Gaussian is also going to be a Gaussian random variable. Remember that for any Gaussian, we need to know the mean and the variance if it's a single random variable, or the covariance if we have multiple random variables. So basically, there is nothing here but the equation of a Gaussian random variable. And this Gaussian random variable is shown with y bar and of course cy. So we need to find these two. Now, how do we find them? Here are the two equations that we need to solve any problem. So if you are not following up with the details of the math, we're saying any linear transformation of Gaussian random variables will result in also a Gaussian random variables with mean equal to t times the mean of x. And to find the covariance, you need to multiply t by cx by t transpose. We'll see this in two examples. In the following slide, before I go to the example, I'm sharing with you the derivation steps. So somebody would say, how did we get this? So quickly just go over the details. The definition of the covariance of y, by definition, it's the expected value of y minus y bar. And then we will replace this with its equivalent x. Okay, and remember that for the transpose, we are changing the order. Now, t and t transpose are not random, so they go outside the expectation. And finally, what remains inside the expectation is the definition of the covariance of x. So this is how we find the relation. Okay, and if you want to find the inverse of y, you can do it as the inverse of everything here, and that will split in the following format. So we have tt transpose. Okay, we find the inverse multiplied by cx inverse multiplied by t inverse. Now we can also find the determinant of cy. If you're just interested in the magnitude, okay, then we can use this notation, because we have t and t inverse, so it will be the magnitude of t squared, the determinant of t squared, multiplied by the determinant of c. The determinant of cy equals to the determinant of t squared times the determinant of cx. The Gaussian random variable at the input is given by the following. The Gaussian random variable at the output will be the following. The difference is now we have to transform. We have to get c of y, which we got through the transformation. Okay. Now, for the case of, you just need to notice here that we are having the transformation here. So just give me the transformation. I'll be able to substitute and get you the output. Here is a numerical example. Example one says the linear transformation of Gaussian random variable is given by the following. Find the joint output. If we are given the joint input and we are told, remember here it says they are zero mean. So x bar equal to zero, x bar one, x bar two equal to zero. We're given the variances for the output and the covariance between them. So we should be able to do it straightforward. These are the transformation. These are linear transformations, so we need to find the mean of y1 and the mean of y2. I mean, we can do it by inspection, because the input cx1, the input x1 and x2 are zero mean, so any linear transformation will result in also zero mean. So now we can say that y1 bar equal to zero, and also y2 bar should equal to zero. The transformation. To build the transformation, I'm getting the entries here. From y1 to y2, this is 1, this is minus 2. We have 3 here, and we have 4 here. So this is the transformation matrix. Okay, so we are good to go now. We are having the transformation matrix. We can build the covariance matrix. So in the question, we are told that this entry must be here. We have x, y. Let me just take this out again. So here we have x, we have y here, we have x, we have y here. So this is sigma x, and this is sigma y squared, sigma x squared, or sigma x1, sigma x2. This is x1, x2, x1, x2. So the out of diagonal element, these are the covariances, which is 3, as shown here. So they are going to be the same. Okay, now we are ready to find the output. The output we need to find, we already know the mean, so we can find the output covariance from the equation. So this is t, and this is t transpose. T transpose means, now this is this column is going to, this row is going to be this column, and the second row is going to be the second column. Now you multiply, you can start by multiplying these two matrices and then get the answer, then multiply by the third matrix. Or if you want to do it through MATLAB or whatever software or calculator you have, you get the following answers. Now what are these? This is C sigma y1 squared, this is sigma y2 squared, and this is the C y1 y2. You can see we are getting the same answer here. So now we are ready to substitute in the equation. So back to that, you can start from the bivariate equation or the multivariate equation, and then substitute. We can find the covariance coefficient by multiplying the CY1, CY2 by the square root of the variances, and that turns out to be minus 0.7. Okay, so it might make some sense because we're having the minus coming from this relation in the linear line. It used to be positive covariance, but the relation between y1 to y2 turned out to be negative, and it makes sense because this could be the reason behind that. Okay, now the joint PDF is this. We just substitute the numbers. On the right hand here, we can implement this using MATLAB. So we can generate a multivariate Gaussian random variable. And there's a command in MATLAB called MV multivariate normal random variable. It will allow you to feed in the coefficient here, including the covariance, and it will generate samples accordingly. If you want to get a similar plot like the one we have here, you can use scatter. You can also use the covariance command and the covariance coefficient. There are already MATLAB commands for every one of them. So we start with a joint uncorrelated, then we can introduce some correlation between them, and then we do the transformation, and then we can see how the transformation results into negative correlation. Okay, I will leave you with the MATLAB code, so you can try the MATLAB code. I will be sharing the code in the description or in my personal website, so please visit these websites. Thank you again, and hope to see you in coming videos. Please share, like, and share with your friends. All right, before we conclude, here is how the MATLAB code looks like. You can cut and paste, start from the left, and then cut the other part on the right, and you can try it on MATLAB yourself. Thank you again.